Good morning. Appreciate everybody being here today. Next week, Donna and I and the kids will be out of town, and so Benjamin's going to take the lesson, so you'll get a professional standing up here. That'll be a nice change of pace. Before we begin, I've asked Brother Tarver to lead us in a word of prayer, and then we'll dive into lesson number 10. So Donna was finishing her lesson this week, and she gave me all the answers, thankfully. And the comment that she made afterwards was, it's really dark, and it's really depressing. And when you read it all, you know, as we're doing it, you see the progression of that in his life, and we don't oftentimes look at it that way. We'll go and we'll look at this story, we'll look at that story, but when you read it as the progression, it really strikes you. It is depressing. We're getting into a really, really rough time. Last week we focused on David's sin with Bathsheba, and we mentioned, though, that sin was kind of the turning point in terms of his reign and his life, and that would have far-reaching implications. And does anybody remember, there were four of those from 2 Samuel. Does anybody remember any of the implications at this moment? Yes, sir, J.D. The sword would not depart from his household. Yes, sir. The child would die because of the sin. I will take your wives. Remember how Ahithophel gave him that counsel? So I will take your wives and give them to your neighbor. And then the fourth one was about him. You shall not die, but as Hunter mentioned, the child shall die. And number two was, I will raise up evil against you from your own house. And we skipped ahead last week to look at the consequences as it related to Ahithophel and Absalom, and that was quite striking. But this morning we're going to talk about the consequences, another of the consequences that will come true. The second one there, I will raise up evil against you from your own house. So who was Amnon? Who was Amnon?
David's oldest son,
his firstborn son. Where was Amnon born? In Hebron, right. So there were six of them that were born in Hebron. There was Amnon, and then there was a young man named Chileab. I'm probably not saying that right, but Chileab. And what do we know about Chileab? Nothing. He's never mentioned again. So most likely he passed away either early in childhood or some point, but nothing is ever mentioned about Chileab again. And then number three is Absalom, also born in Hebron. What's interesting about Absalom, I think, is that if you think about all the sons that David had, who had the most noble pedigree? It was Absalom. So when you read the accounts of who was born to who, Amnon was born to Ahinoam of Jezreel, but Absalom was born to Maacah, the daughter of Talmai, king of Geshur. So he had a king on his mother's side, and he had a king, obviously, as his father. And Geshur was located east of the Jordan, up in this area here. Now, there are some scholars that put it down here, actually, east of Egypt, but most likely it was here east of the Jordan, east of the Sea of Galilee area there. There was also a young man named Jonadab. So in our story from 2 Samuel, the 13th chapter, Jonadab is a cousin of Amnon, and specifically referred to. Do anybody remember how he was referred to? His kind of moniker? He was a very crafty fellow. He is a very crafty fellow. And he gives Amnon some advice because he was lusting after his own half-sister Tamar. Unfortunately, as we read, this results in the rape of Tamar and then Amnon's further mistreatment of her by sending her away. Now, it wasn't done in secret. Jonadab knew, and it looks like other people knew about his feelings, because when Absalom specifically asked Tamar, he asked her specifically if Amnon had been with her. So Tamar then really disappears from the history books, says that she's desolate. She's a lonely, desolate woman in her brother's house. We saw Ahithophel last week nurse his anger at David for his mistreatment of Bathsheba and Uriah. But we also see here in this week's section that there are a lot of grudges that can be nursed. And Absalom nurses a grudge as well. And he puts into place this plan, a two-year plan. And why do you think he waited 2 years? Just curious. Why do you think he waited 2 years? What would have happened if he had invited Amnon, the sons, hey, let's go take a trip out in the wilderness and we'll have a sheep shearing party? Do you think Amnon would have gone? No way. Not a chance. So he lets tensions die down over the course of about 2 years. And then he, as we know, he kills Amnon. And where does he go? He flees. He goes to Geshur. Why would he go there? Whoa, whew, hey, back up. That's where his granddad is. That's where his granddad, the king. So he stays for 3 years, and he was there until who kind of manufactures his return? Who kind of coordinates it? And this is important, actually. Joab. Joab kind of manufactures his return, but his return to court wasn't as quick as he'd like it, so he takes it out also on Joab by burning his field. Do you remember that story? So he burns his field. By the time Absalom actually returns to court, it's been 7 years. 7 years since Amnon's original sin with Tamar, and then 5 years since Absalom had murdered Amnon. He'd clearly put some time and thought into his next plan. I mentioned Chileab. He's never mentioned again, but as far as Absalom's concerned, where would that place him in the succession to the throne? He's the first up. He's the heir apparent. So he sees himself as the heir. He sees himself, he's the guy that's going to take over. He's now back in Jerusalem. He starts courting people. But it would take another 4 years for Absalom to put his plan into action. And it's really more of a grassroots effort. What's he do? He goes to the gates and he starts building alliances and affiliations with people, helping them solve their problems. And also interesting, we mentioned this last week, when he finally pulls the trigger and goes to Hebron to establish himself king, Ahithophel, David's counselor, is a willing and eager participant in the rebellion, in the conspiracy. And he goes to Hebron. Interestingly, he doesn't go to Jerusalem. He goes to Hebron. Why do you think that is? Where was David crowned king of Judah? In Hebron. Lots of stuff happened in Hebron. But David, and he also needed to get out of the city where he could do this and kind of get his people together and then march into Jerusalem. But David receives word, and seeing the scope of the rebellion and all the people that had gone with Absalom, including some that were unsuspecting, the people that had gone to actually to the feast or to the sacrifice, pardon me. So David receives word, and he flees Jerusalem before he can be killed or captured. And he takes with him those who are loyal to him. He sets up lines of communication using the sons of the priests. And the Ark of the Covenant is brought out, and he sends the Ark of the Covenant back. And when you read those, I don't know if y'all got the same feeling, but when I read this section of chapter, there's almost this kind of resolution to the issue, there's this kind of acceptance to this, that David's actions, he has this understanding, really, of why this is all happening, this just resolute action, resolute feeling. So he leaves Jerusalem, and he goes across the Jordan, and he goes to Mahanaim. Now, I'm going to ask you here in a second what's significant about Mahanaim, but just as a real tough question, it's mentioned, it's kind of a side note in chapter 15, verse 30, but what direction does David go specifically, north, south, east, or west, when he leaves Jerusalem? Anybody know? He goes east. I think this is the east where we're staying right here. He goes east. He goes east outside of the city of Jerusalem. Where does he go? Up the ascent of the Mount of Olives. Specifically mentions that. He goes up the Mount of Olives, weeping as he goes, barefoot, to the place where God is worshipped. He arrives at that summit, and he meets Hushai, who he sends back to really subvert the counsel of Ahithophel. And we're told again that Ahithophel is incredibly wise, as if you were consulting the word of God directly. So he leaves Jerusalem, goes to the Mount of Olives, and heads on across, and then up to Mahanaim. What is significant about Mahanaim? What king had his capital or his base of operations at Mahanaim? Remember this from way back. Yes, Ishbosheth. Ishbosheth was at Mahanaim, and that's where he was. David was in Hebron, and they met in battle. Now, David is going to be at Mahanaim. Absalom is going to come from Hebron, and they're going to meet here in the forest of Ephraim with their forces, their men, their military, their armies. In chapter 16, after he's left, as he's going on his way, we get a couple of interesting stories. Ziba, who cared for Mephibosheth, Jonathan's son, as well as Shimei, who curses David and his people. And in verse 11 of that chapter, David rebukes Abishai, Joab's brother, because he wants to cut his head off. He says, let me go over there and take his head off. And David says, behold, my own son seeks my life. How much more now may this Benjaminite? Leave him alone. Let him curse. For God has told him to. For the Lord has told him to. David certainly understands the reasons all of this is happening, but it doesn't make it any easier to accept for him, for sure. Hushai, as I mentioned, David was able to insert into Absalom's confidence, and he is able to turn and to circumvent Ahithophel's counsel. Ahithophel, he wanted to take 12,000 men and go after the king himself. I mean, that guy was all in on the conspiracy and his vengeance, obviously, wanting to be fulfilled there. So Ahithophel, who has betrayed his friend, betrayed his king, realizes his counsel has been spurned, goes home and does what? Hangs himself. Goes home and hangs himself. Who does that remind you of? Betrays the king, laments, and kills himself. Judas. It's eerie. Ultimately, David escapes, and I mentioned about Mahanaim. They fight in the land of Ephraim on the east side of the Jordan there, again here in the forest of Ephraim, and his forces are routed. Now, who is going to ultimately kill Absalom? Joab. Why was Joab, do you think, so eager to kill Absalom? He was the one that brought the guy back. He brought him back. He set things in order. He even goes to the king and kind of shames him to bringing him back, even though he's in the city. He's never seen him for 2 years. He shames him, and then what's he get in return? He gets his field burned. So Joab's not too happy with Absalom for a number of reasons, and he winds up killing him himself. And then we are left with this tragic scene at the end of chapter 18. Hearing the news of Absalom's death and the crushing of the rebellion should be good things, but instead we get these words of grief. Oh, my son Absalom, my son Absalom, would I had died instead of you. Oh, Absalom, my son, my son. The grief just pours out in those words. And I would think, if you read what I read, that the stories of Amnon and Absalom, when we think about David's multifacets of his life, the facet of his life as a parent comes into stark question here. I think both of these stories reflect negatively upon David's actual experience as a father, and we're actually given insight into David's parenting practices in 1 Kings, the first chapter in verse 6. It says, his father, this is talking about Adonijah, his father had never at any time displeased him by asking, why have you done thus and so? So I ask in question number one, why do you suppose David didn't correct or punish his sons? Yes, sir.
But ironically, last week in Psalm 51, we saw David talking about, I'll turn here he really seems to not follow through on that. He doesn't seem to provide justice or punishment at all, and so when he doesn't talk to Amnon about that, he eventually allows Absalom back. So then when Absalom is building the conspiracy, one of the things he tells people is, you're not going to get justice from David. That's why you need me. So this may be even broader than what we see just with his sons. And interestingly, when Joab goes to try and bring Absalom back into the court, one of the things he has the wise woman say, he has her talk about God, in 2 Samuel 14, verse 14, like water spilled on the ground, which cannot be recovered, so we must die. But God does not take away life. Instead, he devises ways so that a banished person may remain estranged from it. Which I think has some truth to it, but there's also some element of justice with God. He does bring people back. And David seems to just focus on that. You know, God forgives. And he misses kind of the need for repentance.
So I totally agree with you. And so if you couldn't all hear that, there's this idea of justice and the idea that he's missing the part about repentance. In fact, that's what makes David so special, and yet he doesn't apply the same rules for his kids or teach that to his kids. He demonstrated that throughout his life, but he didn't teach that. Stephen.
Hypocritical, maybe in correcting his son, if he believed he brought about some of these things as a punishment. Maybe he felt guilt still over it, and he couldn't bring himself to accuse his son of something that he may himself have been guilty of, as far as being deceptive and eventually murdering someone, those kinds of things.
Sure. So could that happen to us as parents? Right, so I could, like, man, I've messed up so many times in that same area. You know, how can I hold you responsible for that? But what's the key, though?
Not just the fact that he sinned. We've all sinned, but it's how we react to that, how we respond.
What's the standard, right? If the standard is me, well, I certainly shouldn't hold you accountable to my standard because I'm not anywhere close to that standard, right? If the standard, though, is God's law, I'm accountable to that, but who else is also? Your children are accountable to that, and you have to hold them accountable to that. And that's where David, I think, made one of his largest mistakes. He didn't hold them accountable for his own, for the same things that he was, the same way that he would react when he was accused of sin. Or, yes, sir?
Were the mothers of his kids Jews?
Some were not. I like where you're thinking, blame it on the wife. I like that. That's good. No, I don't think that's what he was saying. But there certainly are different cultures involved in how they might have handled that, for sure. And what standard were the mothers using, right? There may have been, we know that happened with Solomon, and they even turned him away from idolatry. Any other comments? Yes, sir.
Why God never corrected the having multiple wives? You know, like, we find out later, you know, Jesus said, because of the hardness of your heart, you know, his time's been overlooked, and all that, but it's like the building block of the family. And is it really a wonder why the kids didn't turn out well when you had a house that wasn't really a household, you know, and you have multiple wives plus, you know, multiple concubines? I just always thought about that. It's pretty as serious as it was.
I totally agree with you. Let me ask you this question in return. How widespread was the problem of polygamy in the nation of Israel?
Probably total.
Where else do we see it besides the kings? I may be missing that, but if you can find a place for me besides the kings, I'd be interested to know that. We know it's Solomon. We know it's David. Lamech, yeah, yeah. It's the only other place I can, pardon me? Abraham, Hagar, but that was kind of at the request of his wife. But do you get what I'm at? Yes. Eli had two wives. He had sons, Hophni and Phinehas, but... He had two wives with the handmaiden as well. Yes. Yes.
Solomon only had 1,000 wives and concubines.
He, you know, it's right up there. So it's there, but I don't get the sense that it's a huge issue. At least that's just my impression. Don't recall that, but I'll look that up.
That was part of his, you know, and polygamy.
It's said to it. It's not David, but if you would, it's the, oh man, I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
That's always, I think to your point, Ryan. You know, why is it that God would have allowed he did, and I can't answer all the reasons as to why. Yeah.
He had rules for kings, right? He had rules for kings, specific rules for kings. I don't recall that was one of them, but they weren't supposed to multiply horses and chariots and things of that nature. They're supposed to rely upon him. Yes, sir.
Allowed it so much as he permitted it.
Tolerated it. Yeah, no, I get it. That's kind of...
Truly, because of the hardness of your heart.
Yes. Yes, sir.
In the prophecy, Samuel told the people if they had kings that they would take their daughters for their wives and stuff like that.
Yeah. When Samuel was telling them, hey, you really don't want a king, this is what's going to happen. Yeah. So it's interesting. I don't have all the answers for that. It's always made me uncomfortable as well. Clearly, they're not in the New Testament. Right, and there were different customs and even different tolerances that God allowed at the time.
The book of Ruth, right? What marriage and taking care of each other should be.
Yeah.
Common people, I think, sometimes.
And that's kind of my impression that this was not something that was widespread across the nation. Yes, sir. About his sins, yeah. It was the Bathsheba. Yeah, you stole your Uriah's wife. I would have given you more. Yeah. Thanks. Okay. So as we look at this section of passage, I think these really tragic events shine through in the Psalms that we've read for this morning, and the the depth of David's despair as his life is again in danger, this time by his own son. So in Psalms 13, this psalm to me is one of those psalms that's very troubling. David feels and states that God has abandoned him. We have to not only notice, but we have to accept the fact that David actually feels abandoned by God. I'd like to say that no one will ever feel this way once they've become a disciple of Jesus, but that's clearly not the case in David's standpoint. From his even this tight and deep relationship that he had with God, as we noted in other psalms that he's written, there are times when he's felt distant from God. There's times when David felt that separation. And there are times, most likely, when we feel distant from God, when things are going so badly that you feel he's abandoned you. So what can we do when we feel abandoned by God? I think David gives us some excellent recommendations here from Psalms 13. Let's read Psalms 13. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I take counsel in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all the day? How long shall my enemy be exalted over me? Consider and answer me, O Lord my God. Light up my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death, lest my enemy say, I have prevailed over him, lest my foes rejoice because I am shaken. But I have trusted in your steadfast love. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. I think the first thing we notice in this, as we read the psalm, is this repetition of the statement, how long? David asks, how long will God forget? How long will God hide his face? How long must he wrestle with his thoughts and sorrows? And how long will his enemies triumph? Four times David cries out to the Lord, how long? And we're really left with this impression that whatever David is crying about has been going on, it feels like, for some length of time. And this duration of David's suffering has been so long that David asks if God is going to forget him forever. Many of us have had times of such despair. I would imagine that when it's difficult to even remember when better times exist, you're down in the dumps that far, that feeling of loss, that feeling of abandonment, so great that you can't even see the end of the, you don't even know if there's a tunnel, much less a light at the end of the tunnel. But isn't that the very nature of trials? Rarely when you're in the middle of the trial do you see either the eventual outcome or even the timeline that's associated with that trial. And that's the type of emotion that David here is expressing with his words. When we consider the life of David being a man after God's own heart, it's easy for us to recall the positive things that happened in David's life. Those are the fun ones. But David became a man after God's own heart, not because everything was rosy. On the contrary, what we're reading now, but because of how he handled the sufferings and the trials he encountered. Further in chapter 13 here, David goes further and says, how long will you hide your face from me? This is more of an idiomatic expression used in several times in the scriptures to speak about the blessings of God. God seems so far removed from him that it seems God is no longer even blessing David. The protection, the refuge, the safety that David had appreciated, the Lord seems to have taken those away. He's in a situation now where he sees none of that. That expression also kind of, for us, we would kind of think about that, well, he's in the good graces, or he's not in the good graces of God any further. And that's not an uncommon feeling. It's not an uncommon feeling for us when things go wrong or troubles come. Where's God? Why has he left me? What's happened to the Lord who's been watching over me? This is the type of language that David is using. Why is God hiding his face from me? And not only is David dealing with the feeling of abandonment towards God, but he's also wrestling with his own flood of these emotions. David says that he wrestles with his thoughts and his sorrows in his heart every day. He's describing this depth of despair. Have you been in that situation where you just can't, it's spinning in your head, you can't get it out of your mind. You go to bed, you're thinking about it. You can't get it out. He's wrestling with these emotions. He's suffering in it. And we'd like to say, just stop thinking about it. Give it up. You know, just let's get on with things. But that warring, that battle in our minds, David expresses so well. He knows also that in reality, and we'll read at the end of that chapter, knows in reality that God hasn't left him. He really hasn't left him. So there's this battle, though, being waged by David, where he feels abandoned by him. He feels out of his favor. And he's wrestling with what he knows versus these feelings of despair that have caught him up and have caught him in this cycle of despair and despair, cycle of suffering. And he even describes the depth of despair when he points out that his sorrow is like on an everyday basis, every day, all day. It's so significant that every day goes by, he feels the weight and the burdens of that sorrow on his soul. He is truly standing in this valley of despair, and he's looking for a way up, or he's looking for a way out of that valley. He also asks in the first two verses there, how long will his enemies triumph over him? It seems that that when things are going bad, there's plenty of others ready to kick you when you're down and to pile on, kind of that whole dog pile idea. There's people ready to kick you. David expresses that same feeling as his enemies continue to rule and triumph over David. So David's prayer changes in verses 3 and 4. He says first, look on me. The first thing David does is he turns to God in prayer. This is really, this part of the psalm is really a petition to the Lord about what he's enduring. And isn't that the first thing we should do when trouble hits us? No matter what situation that may come upon us, the first thing that we should do is turn to God in prayer. In verse 3, David says, "Look on me." Literally, David is asking God to turn his face, see what's happening, and regard, give regard to David again. And consideration. I don't always do that. I get so wrapped up in that problem, whatever that is, I forget that that's the avenue I have. That's the avenue I should take immediately. That's the first thing I should do and reach out to. It's really easy to bemoan and to feel that God's not paying attention to me. God's not with me. He's turned his back on me. But even when David feels that way, what does he do? He asks God, turn, consider me, think about me. He doesn't throw in the towel. He doesn't walk away. He doesn't give up on God. He doesn't stop believing. Instead, when he's in the valley of despair, he turns to God. And that's the example we need to remember. We turn to God, and then we tell him the despair, the sorrow, and ask for his consideration, ask for his regard. David not only asked God to look on him and give him consideration, but he also asked God to give an answer to what he's asking for. His prayer isn't simply asking God for something, but also asking God to answer according to his will. It's not just, fly in the sky things. His heart is ready to accept God's answer. Whatever that answer is, he's ready to accept it. How do we know that? Because the next statement, give light to my eyes. Instead of being lost in this, David desires light to begin. What do you think he's asking for? Give light to my eyes.
Let me see what's going on. Let me see this answer.
Let me see. Give me understanding from whose perspective? God's perspective, right? I'm looking up. I'm in this valley of despair. I can't see. All I see is what's going on. Give light to my eyes. Let me see things the way you see them. He doesn't want to be in the misery that he's in. He feels like he's at the point of death. And the idea is that David wants to see things the way God sees them. When we look at the suffering that we're going through, it doesn't make sense. Why is this happening to me? Why are these people coming down on me? Why are they kicking me when I'm down? Asking the Lord to open our eyes so that we can see the way God sees, the way God is working through the situation. That won't always be obvious, and even David acknowledges that. But instead of this fleshly, carnal worldview that we have, let our eyes have light. Let's look at things from the way God sees them. And how do we do that? By understanding God's will, by understanding his reference point. It's not about us. We're not the center of the universe. David doesn't want the enemies to be able to think that they can overcome the servant of the Lord. We've seen that with Moses. Moses, it's almost as this shaming thing, right? You don't let somebody say they can defeat a servant of the Lord. Moses made that similar argument when the Lord wanted to kill all the people. Let the righteous be victorious over the wicked. We're trying to be righteous. Don't let my enemies prevail. Don't let them triumph, and don't let them rejoice over the fact that they're triumphing. In verses 5 and 6, David really now changes gears in these last two verses and describes the hope that he has. He's so down in the dumps, he still has hope. Despite all that we've seen in this psalm about how bad things are going for him, David still has hope. Why? What's David say? David points out that these things are a matter of faith. David has put his trust in the Lord, and how can he do that? How can David have trust in the Lord? He's at this terrible time in his life. David, is he exhibiting blind faith? Not at all. He trusts in the Lord's unfailing love. When you think back, when has God never not delivered David? Can you list a time? Everything that we've read, when has David not been delivered by God? Yes, sir.
It's a funny thought. I was thinking the other day, I was praying and I said, thank you to God for being faithful. And then I thought, that's so ironic that God is faithful. We're the ones, the the creator of all was faithful to us.
It is a beautiful concept, and it's hard for us to understand it. The fact that we're not faithful at all times, and yet God is unfailing. He's perfect in that sense. His love never goes away. His faithfulness never goes away. His plan never go awry. His plans are consistent and promised and perfect. He's proven his love for us as Christians by sending his son to die. When? What does Romans 5 verse 8 say? He saved us. He sent his son to die, even in our sins, because we were doing everything right. No. Sending his son to die while we were in our sins. If God would show that much love to send his son while we don't deserve it, why would we doubt the love of God when we're trying to serve him? Doesn't make any sense. We have reason to trust in the Lord. We have hope for tomorrow because of the Lord's unfailing faith and love that he has shown to us. God will not let us down. We put our full trust in him. He will not come up short. And then David rejoices in that salvation. The next reason he has hope, knowing that the Lord has not abandoned him, is because of the Lord's salvation. There is a reason to rejoice. All of us have this reason to rejoice. We may be going through the pits of despair. Things may be going worse than they ever have. What do we know is true? God is faithful. God's plan for us is true. That doesn't die. Who can separate us from the love of Christ? Who can separate us? Shall affliction or anguish or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come nor powers nor height nor depth nor any other created things will have the power to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 8, 35 through 39. Paul's making that same point. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Finally, David says that he will sing to the Lord, for he has been good to him. New King James and English Standard say that David will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully, bountifully with me. The bountiful goodness of God has overflowed towards us. David expresses earlier in the psalm that the Lord's face has been hidden from him, has turned from him, meaning that the blessings of God have been removed. But David now recognizes that is not the case. How can we know that God has not turned his face from us? How can we know that God will indeed bless us? Same reason that David could know that God would remain with him, because God had done so in the past, continually, with his people. We can see that continual pattern. David really speaks in the past tense. God has been good to him. God has dealt bountifully with me. If God had done these things in the past, why would he not continue? He loves his children. His love is unfailing. Why would we doubt that God would not continue to take care of us? He ends this psalm that starts off so sad. He ends this psalm in what? Praise. Praise to his God, the God who keeps his promises and loves us without fail. That is a beautiful psalm. Let's turn to Psalms, the third chapter. Yes, sir.
Jim, when I went to worship with, said once, no one has a monopoly on troubles. We seem to think that our troubles are worse than anybody else's because we're living them and we're going through them. Sometimes to the point where we may think, how could a loving God, ...
Right.
We're not sure, I'm not sure to what extent David is talking about salvation here. We know that later the idea of a Messiah was for an earthly kingdom, or the thought of to be freed from the oppression of the Romans. How much greater our understanding is, though the difficulties be great, though the pains be great, though it occupies so much of our time and energy, that this too
So, absolutely true. I think about that passage in Romans, the 8th chapter, Paul making that similar point, and in Hebrews, where it talks about them suffering through these things that you haven't even suffered yet to this point, and yet we have a Savior. That's already happened. It's a done deal. The book of Revelation tells us that the victory's won. It's over. We just have to be a part of the winning team. And that's always promised to us. Psalms 3. Thank you, brother. Psalms 3 is really, despite that we know Psalms 2 is actually David's as well. We know that from quotation in the New Testament. But in the book of Psalms, this is the first psalm that's actually attributed to David. Also speaks to the first one to speak to a specific situation. And it says, when he fled from Absalom, his son, things are in disarray. His friends and his family are against him. Old enemies are gloating. It is looking really, really bleak for David the king. Let's read Psalms, the 3rd chapter. O Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. Many are saying of my soul, there is no salvation for him in God. But you, O Lord, are a shield about me, my glory and the lifter of my head. I cried aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. I lay down and slept. I woke again, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you strike all my enemies on the cheek. You break the teeth of the wicked. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessings be on your people. As the psalm opens, we read about the problems of David. David begins with this exclamation to the Lord concerning the great number of enemies and the foes that are all around him. They've risen up against him. And things are so bad for this man, who's after God's own heart, that even people are saying, what are they saying about him? God's no longer with him. Clearly. That's kind of the same story that we read that Ben talked about in the book of Job. Things are so bad that people are saying, clearly, God's not with him anymore. God's not going to deliver him. And how depressing that must be. How depressing that must have been for David, for people around him to suggest that you're getting what you deserve. How difficult to hear people say that God is not going to help us out of our turmoil. During times of distress like this, David leaves us with a great example. Express your grief to God. We have the right to bring our grief and our turmoil before God. David begins this psalm, O Lord, in his call to God concerning his difficult and tragic circumstance. And he desires that we bring our problems to him. In fact, Hebrews 4th chapter says that we can go before the throne of grace to receive help in our time of need. David's first reaction is correct and one that we should emulate when we're in a time of need. When trouble comes, we turn to God. When problems appear on every side, turn to the Lord. Make that our first response. In verses 3 and 4, David speaks of the confidence that he has in the Lord. How is it possible? How is it possible that David's surrounded by his enemies and he's still able to turn in confidence to God? David's no longer focusing on the woes he's facing, but now he's focusing on God instead. That's really the fundamental difference when you look at the spies that were sent in Numbers 13th chapter. You think about the 12 spies that were sent in Numbers 13. Why did the 10 say they could not conquer the land? They were focused on who? The enemies, the people, the giants, right? The two, Joshua and Caleb, who were they focused on? They were focused on God, right? This is a stark example of that. David expresses three great things that God was for David. First, he says David says that the Lord is his shield. In the midst of trouble, David has something that will protect him, and the Lord's shield fully surrounds him. The shield of God, there are no parts that were left exposed. He says, you are my glory. David is saying that the Lord is his glory. Though David is suffering the loss of his kingdom, and at this point, potentially the loss of his life, he still finds his glory in the Lord. David is suffering ridicule and cursings by his people. But David doesn't find glory in the words of man. What he finds glory is, he finds glory in the Lord. Then he says, you lift up my head. David really is describing what God is able to do for those of us who are downcast. He is able to support us. He is able to lift up our head. This is this picture. I see this picture in my mind of this utter despair, such that you know, just hanging your head low. You're just so downcast. But God is able to lift our heads. In Hebrews, the 12th chapter, verses 3 and 4, it says, "For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself," speaking of Jesus, "lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. You have not yet resisted the bloodshed, striving against sin." We got troubles. We've got tribulations. We've got things that have happened bad to us. But while they're difficult, they're truly small. We have not yet resisted the bloodshed. We've not suffered the same way those first century Christians have suffered. The things that we suffer, momentary. Always we must remain focused that we have never and will never endure more than Jesus has already endured for us. David knows that his cries are being heard by the Lord and that he's going to receive an answer. This is true confidence and trust in the Lord, to know that though God is invisible, that God is listening, and that God will respond. David has complete faith in God to rescue him. And in verses 5 and 6, in the midst of that, all that trouble, fleeing for his life, David says that he's able to lie down and sleep. When you've been in the depths of despair, have you been able to sleep? I haven't. When things are going that bad and it's just spinning around my head, I can't get rid of it, I'm not sleeping well. But David says he's able to lie down and sleep. Tens of thousands have drawn up against him. One of his best friends has turned against him. How's that possible? You'd expect anxiety and worry to just grab him and seize him. But David has confidence that he could go to sleep and that God would bring him through. God would bring him through to another day. He would survive to last another day. But ultimately, he's being protected even while he slept. He says that the Lord sustains him. We don't typically use that word. We'll use a word like sustenance, though, talking about the things that keep us alive, food, water. And while on the run, it's the Lord that is giving sustenance to David. The Lord is what's keeping David going. And the ability to see that, the Lord as the one who sustains us through those difficulties and will pull us through to the other side. That's what David is telling us, and that's what's important for us as Christians as well. David concludes the psalm with this cry for deliverance. There is a cry for confidence as he asks for deliverance. Verse 4 states that he knows God is answering his prayer. David prays again for the people, not just concerned about his own well-being, but he's desiring good and righteousness to be with the people of God. I'm not going to get to Psalms 55. I will cover that. Maybe I can get Benjamin to cover that because it's interesting. I think it relates to the story with Ahithophel. But we just have a couple of minutes, 2 minutes exactly, in fact. So I want us to consider the words of Psalms 3 and this shield about me. I hope you know this song. It's not in our books, but hopefully will be in the future. And while we don't really know what the word Selah means in these Psalms, it's thought it may represent some type of musical instruction to either increase the volume or stress placed upon a verse. So as we sing A Shield About Me, it'll be here in the front. Let's add our own Selah at the Hallelujah. Use this one because my eyes aren't that good. Do me. Thou, O Lord, art a shield.